Proverbs chapter 14, if you will. And I want to look at verse number 34. Righteousness exalteth the nation, but sin is a reproach unto any people. Father, we thank you tonight for your word, and I just pray we think about these things in these passages that we'll be looking at, that they might have a settling impact in our lives and also equip us with clear thinking about living in the day and the age we live in a way that honors you and benefits those about us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You know, yesterday another school shooting has cast a shadow over our nation. And it's just another one of these tragic things. It's laid bare the frustration and the utter emptiness of the leadership of our nation at this time. I didn't actually see it, but I read about it. The president, he gave an address last evening, and he's lost a child himself, so would be some of the emotion, the ability to connect with that. But then he stomps his foot and says, I just can't put up with this anymore. But you listen to it and you say, obviously, frustration, agitation, but no answers. Today at lunch today, at noontime, if you saw the governor of the state of Texas and the officials all there, everything from the mayor of the city and all the law enforcement and so forth, he had a news conference where he was giving, the details of what was going on. And when he finished speaking, before the next person spoke, a guy got up and came up and interrupted the thing and screaming about getting guns off the street. You shouldn't have guns in Texas and that kind of stuff. And so, make a political moment out of it. Then later on during the press conference, the Texas governor was asked by, are you now, the NRA is going to have a meeting in your state in 2 weeks. You're going to tell them it shouldn't come. Are you going to now be for gun control? And he gave what I thought was one of the most cogent answers that I'd heard anybody do. Kind of bold of him. He said, New York, Chicago, and Los Angeles have the strongest anti-gun ownership laws in the world. More people get killed in a weekend on Chicago than have been killed in a month in Texas, school shootings included. And he said, what Chicago is a demonstration, a positive affirmation, and a clear proof that gun laws don't work. And that's true. Because it isn't the gun that kills somebody, it's the person shooting the gun that kills them. Gun will lay there forever and do nothing. He made the point that how many years, I don't know how many it was, they've had guns in Texas. And until recently, they don't have the shootings like this. So there's something going on in the culture. Now, his answer was mental health. And that's, you got the liberals on one side saying we need to get rid of guns, and you got the conservatives on the other side saying we better have better mental health laws and facilities services. And I keep listening for somebody to say something that makes sense. The governor today, he started off by saying, this is wicked. And I thought, well, there's the first time I heard the right word. It's wickedness. And it's genuine wickedness. It really is. But, you hear a lot about people talking about things being systemic problems. This is a real systemic problem. And it's not the gun shootings, but what the real systemic problem is, cultural wickedness. That verse right there tells you something about culture. And about what God says about it. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Look back at verse number 11. The house of the wicked shall be overthrown, but the tabernacle of the upright shall flourish. There's a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. You start out with sin, and sin unrestrained works its way into wickedness. Come with me to Romans chapter 1. It's amazing to me how in the last season, Romans 1 keeps coming back to my mind as here's what's going on. is our culture goes through a reset, and that's the word that's being used now. Came out 4 or 5 years ago in a book written by a liberal sociologist, and that we need a reset, and everything needs to be reset. And I played off of that for our summer conference. The theme in our summer conference is the grace reset, because that's what we really need. But the idea of the culture, Romans chapter 1, the Apostle Paul explained, God in his word explains how this stuff works. Romans 1 verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse, because when they knew God. Now that passage is, historically, this is talking about Genesis chapter 9, 10, and 11. The truth of this is ubiquitous to any age. When they knew God, everyone born in this in the life knows there's a God. There's a real funny YouTube video. I saw this a week or so ago. You know the guy Mark Lowry, the singer, wrote the song "Mary, Did You Know?" He's a comedian too, and he's almost a better comedian than he is a singer to me. But he has this thing about talking to an atheist. And the atheist says, you know, I don't have faith to believe in God. And Mark says, you know, I'd be an atheist if I had enough faith. And he talks about, you know, the obvious thing, look around you, something didn't come from nothing. And he talks about that. Everybody knows. It's the conscience that God put into people. The problem isn't that they don't know there's a God. They all begin high. All begin with an understanding. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. Neither were thankful. But their vain became vain in their imaginations. Now, you have thoughts and imaginations. In your mind, you have thoughts. Thoughts are based in fact. Imaginations are based in dreams. They're not... A fact is a fact. An imagination is something you hope might would be. They became vain in their dreams. They became vain in the things they projected that they wanted their life to be about. And their foolish heart was darkened. When you become vain in your imaginations, your thinking process and the dreams that come out of it become they're empty. The word vain is empty, worthless, valueless. No substance to it. They became vain. The thinking, they reject divine viewpoint, and their human viewpoint is of no value. Professing their foolish heart was darkened. The light of the word goes out, and so that word is light. Take the light out, take the word out, there's darkness, ignorance. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. There's a complete lack of God's truth. We don't want what God says. We want to do our own thing. Every man does that which is right in his own eyes. I'm going to do what I think's best for me, for what I want to do. And you wind up with wreckage as you're going down through the passage. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God in an image made like the corruptible man, the birds, the four-footed beasts, creeping things. It's that evolution in reverse. Wherefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness. Verse 26, God gave them up unto vile affections. Verse 28, even as God, they did not like to retain God in the knowledge, he gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. All those things that are involved there, that vain imaginations. Come back with me to the book of Genesis, if you would, chapter 6. When they become vain, it starts with these vain imaginations. We're going to reject what God says, and we're going to do what we want to do. If you start in Genesis chapter number 4, the first, 11th chapter of the book of Genesis talk to you about how God set the world up and got it into motion. Genesis 4, after Adam and Eve are cast and out of the garden, they have two boys, Cain and Abel. You know the story. Cain kills Abel, and God puts a curse on Cain that he's going to be a wanderer. He's not going to do that. He goes and sets up a city. Oftentimes, verse 16, Cain went out, Genesis 4:16, and from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod on the east of Eden. And Cain knew his wife and conceived and bare Enoch and builded a city. People, the old Saul is, where did Cain get his wife? I've always said the real question in where did Cain get his wife is where did Mrs. Cain get her husband? Who would have married a dude like that? Well, she did. And obviously by this time, the population on the earth is way beyond just Cain and Abel. If you look at chapter 5, verse number 2, and Adam lived 130 years and begat a son in his own image, after his image, and called him his name Seth. And in the days of Adam after he begat Seth were 800 years, and he begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Adam lived a long time, and he begat sons and daughters. And over a period of time, they had a lot of children, and children had children. So the earth's population had grown. By the time Cain gets his wife, he goes out and he builds a city. There's obviously a large population, a large enough population to have a city. And he names the city after his son. He wants to settle down. God told him, you got to scatter. He said, I'm not going to do what God said. I love the ground. I want to be settled. And he builds him a monument to his own rebellion. The first city built on planet Earth was built in rebellion against God as a monument to man's rebellion. And they develop a culture. And the rest of that chapter, Genesis 4, talks to you about the culture that gets developed. He builds the city in verse 17. Verse 20, and Adah bare Jabal, and he was a father of such as dwell in tents. He gets is such as have cattle. That's agriculture and horticulture and husbandry. And his brother's name was Jubal, and he was the father of all such as handle the harp and organ, music, arts. And by the way, when you have a culture that has arts and music and those kind of things, that is a reflection of the fact that the culture has leisure time. If everybody has to fish and farm and will have something to eat, you don't have time to sit around and sing songs and draw pictures. If you go back in history, the artists and the musicians, the people that develop those kind of entertainment things, it's always people have patrons so that they don't have to work physically, they can work on their art. So what's happening here is a whole culture is being developed. when Jesus talks, as in the days of Noah, this is the days of Noah. This is the culture that developed between Genesis 4 and Genesis 6. Verse number 22, Zillah and she bare Tubal-Cain, an instructor of every artifactor in brass and iron. If you know what brass is, that's metallurgy. They've learned to take compounds and melt them and put them together, and a whole culture is being developed. This stuff extends all the way into the days of Noah. So you come over to chapter 6, where the days, chapter 5, everybody dies except Enoch, so that's a sort of a graveyard chapter. Chapter 6, you're in the days of Noah. And those corruptible things have happened. Verse 5, Genesis 6, 5, God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth. Now, how did that come about? And that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart were only evil continually. That culture had been so captivated by the imaginations of the flesh, by the wickedness that is produced by sinful thinking, that every imagination of the thoughts, all the thoughts that man had, get turned into witty inventions of evil design. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and creeping things and the fowls of the air, for it repented me that I had made him. The corruption that had taken place. So you have the flood. And then in chapter 9, Noah and his boys get off the ark and their wives, and they start all over again. And it isn't long before you come to chapter 11 and you have the Tower of Babel, where they're doing exactly the same thing again. God told Noah and his boys, scatter. Chapter 11, he Nimrod gathers them together, and we're not going to scatter. We're going to build a tower, and we're going to build a city, and we're going to make a name for ourselves. And so God comes down and scatters. I said all the time, the Lord didn't have to work up a sweat to take care of them. He just mixed their languages up so they couldn't talk to each other. And that wasn't such a radical kind of thing. So man then scatters in the earth. Next chapter, he calls out Abraham. But that's when he gave up the Gentile nations. Romans 1 is talking about why he did that. And it had to do with their rejection of the truth. They have the truth of God, but they won't hold it. They hold it in unrighteousness. They change it. They corrupt it. And if you go back to Romans 1, it ends with verse 23, and change the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like the corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. That's pagan religion. They took the glory of the uncorruptible God and changed it into an image. It starts in the mind. It starts in the way you think, your mental picture of who God is and who you are. Verse 25, it says, they changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who's blessed forever. Amen. So in their mind, they get this idea, I want to be God. I don't want to pay attention to what God says. I'm going to be God. We'll be God. We'll make an image that represents who we are. And so they make an image like corruptible man. And then it's four-footed birds, four-footed beasts, creeping things, birds, beasts on the earth, bugs. This goes, it's a downward slope. But you know, if you look at pagan religion in the world, that's exactly what it is. They have images of people, man, and images of animals, creatures. The whole process, what happens is that they're looking for something that their senses can take hold of. That's what the image is about. You know, remember 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9? Eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, neither in the heart of man. Those three ways that you know everything. And so the eye, empiricism, what you can see, what you can feel. You've got five senses. And they develop religion that's designed for your five senses. You can see it, you can touch it, you can feel it, you can smell it, you can see it. It's beautiful. You can hear it. And they develop religion to satisfy those senses. So that you can feel like you know who God is, because you're making yourself God, your will, your thinking. You don't know what God says, get rid of that. We'll do it ourselves. Thank you. Well, the result is God gave them up. Now come down with me to verse 29. Because once God gave them up and gave them over, why? Because they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, verse 28. We don't want what God says. Get rid of that. We'll do it ourselves. Our vain imaginations will develop foolish thinking that develops into what? Verse 28. Even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind, worthless, useless. To do those things which are not convenient. When I read that part of that verse, I say, that's a sweet way of saying this. He's fixing to give you some really nasty things. And he says, these things, the problem with all these things is they aren't conducive to what God intends man to be. They're all destructive. Being filled think I mentioned to you Sunday, when you read in Paul's, anywhere in the Bible, talk about being filled with the Spirit, being filled with fear, being filled with joy. That word filled is the idea of being controlled by it. It comes and saturates you to the point that it dominates you. Being filled, being controlled, being dominated with all unrighteousness. The kind, and he's going to list the kind of things that come in exchange for God's truth. You want to know what happens when you get rid of God's truth? Here it is. Fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covetous, covenant breakers, without natural affections, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. That's the depth to which sin takes you. That's the depth to which unrighteousness takes you. That's the depth to which not liking to retain God in your knowledge takes a culture. Because that's the description, verse 29 to 32, of the culture, of the cultural impact of verse 21 and 22. When you refuse to be thankful, refuse to glorify God as God, when you become vain in your imaginations, your foolish hearts darken, you reject the truth, you develop your own ideas about what to do, who you are, where you ought to go, control yourself, produces ignorance. And the result is, in a culture, those things take over. Come back with me to the book of Jeremiah for a second. Jeremiah chapter 6. You have to understand that in your Bible, God put into print over 2,000 years ago what would happen to a nation that does what Romans 1 says. When you don't like to retain God in your knowledge, he puts it black and white. He'd done it long before Paul. Jeremiah chapter 6. Jeremiah's talking to Israel about the judgment that's going to be carried away into captivity. And he says in verse number 19, starting verse 18, Jeremiah 6, 18, therefore hear, ye nations, and know. You see that word nations? That's Gentiles. Sometimes we say there's no message for the Gentiles in the Old Testament, but there is. He'll address the Gentiles, and when he does, he says, look at what I'm going to do to my people. If I'm going to do that to them, think about what I'll do to you. This is kind of a warning. But he says, gather up the nation. All you Gentiles come here. I want you to see what happens to a nation that doesn't like to retain me in their knowledge. Therefore, hearken, O ye nations, and know, O congregation, there's Israel, what is among them. Hear, O earth, behold, I will bring evil upon this people, that's Israel. They're going to be carried away into Babylonian captivity. Even the fruit of their thoughts, because they had not hearkened unto my words, nor to my law, but rejected it. He says, hey, I want everybody to see what happens when you don't do it, when you have my word and you lay it aside to do it your way. Became vain of their imaginations. Their foolish hearts darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. This is what happens to our culture. If you look back up at verse number 10. No, verse 16, I'm sorry. I knew I was looking at the wrong verse. Verse 16, thus saith the Lord, stands ye in the ways. Now, he's given a way out. He's going to tell them how to not have this happen to him. Stand ye in the ways and see and ask for the old paths. Where is the good way? And walk therein. And you shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. God says, there's hope. Do it my way. Obey my word. Go back to verse number 10. To whom shall I speak and give warning that they may hear? Behold, their ear is uncircumcised, and they cannot hearken. Behold, the word of the Lord is unto them a reproach, and they have no delight in it. They have no interest in what God says. We don't want it. Throw it away. Get out of here, Jeremiah. We don't want to hear what God says. Chapter 8, verse number 9. The wise men are ashamed. They're dismayed and taken. Lo, they have rejected the word of the Lord. And what wisdom is in them? Every time I hear one of our national leaders, political leaders, economic leaders, social leaders, religious leaders, I think of that verse. They don't point to God's word. Listen, when the truth of God's word preached by the body of Christ, all over southern Texas, all over the state of Texas, all over this nation, especially in the southeastern part of it, there are little churches all over. We were in Michigan just Sunday week ago, up in Detroit, and we had the Bible conference there in Wyandotte. And as we're riding down through that section of it's a suburb of Detroit, it's on the river, right across the river is Canada. And my wife said, wow, look at all the churches. And on every corner there's a little Baptist church, a little Methodist church, Campbellite church, all churches everywhere. And the reason for that is that part of Detroit was settled by people from Kentucky and Tennessee and Virginia. When they came up here back in the 30s for jobs in the automobile industry, when the coal mines and stuff in the Appalachians were closed up, all across this country, their little churches were established by, they might not have known everything that you and I might know in the scripture, but they knew Christ died for their sins and knew the gospel and was raised again for justification. They knew the gospel and they knew you got saved and have eternal life and life in Christ by believing that the Lord Jesus Christ is your Savior. And they established little churches to preach gospel ministry. And the era was, those churches are soul-saving stations. That was the phrase that was used over and over. And they populate, and they took the gospel, and all across that part of Texas down there, those little churches are there. If the gospel was going out from those little churches, instead of saying we need mental health, we need more gospel preaching. Because that's where the answer is. But when you take the wisdom of the word, and you say, that's not where wisdom is. That's your religious tradition, and you can have it over there, and you have yours over there, and you have yours over there. But real help is going to have to come from the secular world, the vain imaginations of the foolish hearts of men trying to figure. Listen, the secular world, mental health, psychiatry, they do a good job of diagnosing problems. They just don't have answers for them. I mentioned Sunday, there's a big old book, the Diagnostic Manual of Psychiatry. Got between 400 and 500 abnormal psychology diagnoses in it. The one diagnosis, I remember years ago, I have a copy of the DM3, which has been out of date for about 5 volumes. But I got it back years ago, and I was looking for normal. There's no diagnosis for normal. You got 400 diagnoses of abnormal. They can tell you they can identify problems. They don't have the answers to the problems because they don't understand the difference between the spirit and the soul of man, and they don't understand the issue of sin. Well, when you're looking to answer it yourself, that's what you get. Go back to the Romans just for a second. And just read down through those things. Romans 1:29. being filled with filled with all unrighteousness. That's all the rest of these things come from that. Fornication, sexual immorality, no appreciation for sexual purity, the marriage, wickedness, covetous, wickedness. Wickedness comes, back in Samuel, there's a verse that says, wickedness comes from the wicked. It doesn't just pop out of nowhere. It comes from wicked, the wicked. It's not a implement problem. It's a person problem. Covetousness. Everything you see in our culture is built on that. All advertising is built on making you want something you don't have. Maliciousness. You just think about how malicious people are. Driving here tonight, around early afternoon to the building here, up the freeway. And it's fascinating how malicious people are just driving their cars. And I think, wow, man, that guy's driving crazy. No, that guy's just malicious. He don't care who he runs over. He wants to be first. Full. Those are the sins. Here are the people full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things. Now that when I read that, then it's not satisfied to do what somebody else tells them to do. They're going to sit around and invent some evil things for themselves to do and see how good they can do and how many people they can attract to it. Come back with me to Psalm 106. When you read a list like that, there every one of those things has an illustration in the Bible about it happening. Psalm 105 and 106 is two long psalms about the history of Israel. Psalm 105 talks about how Jehovah works in Israel's history. Psalm 106 talks about Israel's sin in her history. And if you come down to verse number... I've got to sneeze, so just hang on a second. Hold on to your toupee. It doesn't happen very often anymore, but be glad about that. I am. Verse number. Oh, geez. It's hard to break in here. Verse number 28. They joined themselves unto Baal Peor and ate the sacrifice of the dead. Thus they provoked him to anger with their inventions. And a plague broke in upon them. You remember the story of Baal and Balaam and Balak. Balak hired Balaam to curse Israel and he couldn't do it. God wouldn't let him. Numbers 22, 23, and 24. The next chapter, Numbers 25, is what this passage is referring to. You see how he says in verse 30, then stood up Phinehas and executed judgment, and so the plague was stayed. There was God's man in Israel. But what happened is Balak taught the Midianites how to get God to curse Israel. And the way he did it was have them get corrupted by Baal worship. And the Israelites were deceived through enchantments to get involved in Baal worship. And when he did, God sent a plague. And Phinehas is the one who came up and executed the people were guilty of corrupting Israel and stopped the plague. But I just want you to see that thing in verse 29. They provoked him to anger with their inventions. They developed some wise ideas about how to worship, but not God's way. They became religious. Part of the religion that they were involved in was a religion that fostered sexual impurity, homosexuality, to be specific, as well as fornication. And it was a terrible, wicked thing. They sacrificed to the dead. They sacrificed their children. When you get a culture willing to sacrifice its children, why would you do that? Well, you've got these things that you've developed better things to do. Verse number 39, thus were they defiled with their own works and went a-whoring with their own inventions. They're inventors of evil things. And the evil things that they were inventing and developing had to do with corrupting their families, corrupting their religion. They were religious, but it was it wasn't God's religion. Many years ago, I was just a young believer. I heard a missionary, a man who had been on the mission field in South America for about 40 years. And he wasn't one of these missionaries that went for 4 years and came home for a year. He went there and stayed there, lived there. He lived in the bush among some heathen for over 20 years without ever coming back out and seeing any people in the, quote, civilized world. What he did is he went there and he learned their language. Then he wrote down a written language, and then he translated the Bible into their language. And many missionaries back in the late 1800s, early 1900s did that in South America. This man was in Bolivia. And he came home, and he was at a missionary conference, and he talked to the teenagers, and I was one of them. And he said, there are four things that the heathen do. He said, I've been on the mission field for 50 years, and here are four things that the heathen always do. I wrote them down. I've kept them in my Bible. Just remind me. Number one, they take off their clothes. Number two, they paint and pierce their bodies. Number three, they dance to drug-induced hypnotic music. And number four, they're religious. And he went over those things. He said, I want you to see these things. In Exodus 32, that's exactly the things Israel does at the golden calf. This was in the 1960s, when it was exactly what my age group was doing in the culture and has done since. Well, what that gets you? That inventors of... we're going to take an idea and we're going to take our imagination and invent new ways to be evil. Disobedient to parents in the verse 30. Isn't that interesting? 2 Timothy 3, that's in there. Without understanding, we don't know what to do. It's just got to stop. Okay, Joe, how are we going to stop it? Got no idea. If he had to give you an idea, in fact, the only idea he has is to get guns off the street, which, how's that worked out for him? Put more mental health facilities. How about let's get the gospel out? How do you think that's going to work? Would it work? Yeah. Did it work? Yeah. But where are we now? Our culture, until the early 70s, it was an admirable thing to be a Christian. Actually, for centuries, our culture had been cleaned up by Christianity without having life in Christ. But in the mid-70s, things began to change. And while you went from being admired if you were a Christian, in the 80s, the 90s, and the 2000s, it was okay to be a Christian, but it was just kind of neutral. Didn't get you anything. Didn't cost you anything. That's the era of big evil, when all the big mega churches were built. Because they were built on the idea that we can accept everybody. God will accept everybody. When you get in the mid-20s, 205 or somewhere along in there, it began to shift. And instead of being neutral, now you can be Christian and we'll tolerate you, but you just stay in your place. Now, it's we hate you no matter what. You need to understand the culture you live in today and that your kids are going to live in their whole lifetime, it's not tolerable for you to be a Christian. It's not neutral. It's certainly not admired. It's, we don't want you. Your views are unwelcome. Your views on the issues of our culture, we don't. Listen, the abortionists, the gay rights people, the transgender, they don't want to be tolerated. They want to be approved. You can't do that and be Bible, because the Bible doesn't approve any of that. That's the culture that Romans chapter 1 says comes because they didn't like to retain God in their knowledge. Without natural affection. How much natural affection could you be without to shoot your grandma in the face? You know, you just think about that. Implacable. Not going to change. Why would I want to change? Unmerciful. Then you come to that conclusion, knowing the judgment of God, that they would do such things worthy of death. They don't just do them. They have pleasure in them that do them. We're going to have Pride Day. We're not only going to do it, we're going to be proud of doing it and proud of those who help us. And if you're not a part of that, you'll stand on the side and you'll say, well, it's okay. It's your thing. And you'll be afraid to say anything else, because then you lose whatever it is you're trying to hold on to. The culture that comes to its conclusion based on not retaining God in its knowledge is a culture you're going to live in, that you are in right now. If you want to know why kids are killing kids, it's because that's where you're in Romans 1, verse 32. The answer isn't in making excuses. Chapter 2, therefore, thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever art thou that judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself. What's the first thing everybody said? The news, all the news media, the politicians, immediately, get rid of guns. Who art thou that judgest another? You do the same thing. Blame the other guy. Verse number 2. But we're sure that the judgment of God is according to truth. The culture won't know how to judge, but God does. Chapter 3, verse number 9. What then? Are we better than they? No, in no wise. For we have before proved, both Jew and Gentiles, that they're all under sin. As it is written, there's none righteous, no, not one. What do you do about that? Verse 21, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifest, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto whom and upon whom all them that believe. I read that verse wrong. Verse 22, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. For there's no difference. You know what the answer is? Life in Christ. The answer is you're a sinner. The world's a sinner. I must have at least once every other month somebody asked me, if you're a homosexual, does that mean you're going to go to hell? Can a homosexual be saved? Listen, God doesn't save people on the basis of how they have sex. He saves you whether or not you trusted his son or not. Now, should you be a homosexual? No. But that doesn't. You go to hell because you're lost, because you're a sinner, and because you haven't trusted a Savior that God's provided. It's not this sin, that sin, the other sin. It's faith in Christ that's the issue. And that's the only place there's an answer. But that answer has to be bigger than just a moment. It has to be an answer that people, that has the opportunity to then have the life of Christ affect the world in which we live. Come with me to Philippians chapter 1. Here's a passage that verse 27, Paul is exhorting the Philippians. Philippians 1:27. Only let our conversation be as becometh the gospel of Christ. So when you're living your life, let your life be as becometh, that it is attractive to the gospel of Christ. That whether I come and see you or else I'm absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. First thing to do, stand fast in the truth of God's word. You've got to learn it. You've got to live it. For the assembly, have one mind striving together. Be involved in a work of ministry that's focused on getting the word out into you and out to others. And in nothing terrified by your adversaries. Now here's the fun part. Them dudes out there in the world aren't going to like you. If you're my age, you've lived through. Sunday morning I was using the illustration about reading a book, how to read a book. And I started to say something about a phone book. And to look out at the congregation, I realized about 75% of you never even saw a phone book. You know what a phone book is. I'm saying, oh, you know. Did you see this week that they finally took out the very last payphone in New York City? The last payphone in New York City was removed. Where's Superman going to change? That's my first thought, you know. Nothing terrified by your adversaries. I lived through that. You admired to be a Christian, tolerated, hated. Some of you have never known anything except the tolerated. Stay in your place and it's okay. And you're experiencing the anger now. I watched one of the leading evangelical heroes of the 80s and the 90s, and the 90s and the 2000s. A guy named Tim Keller, he's one of the leaders in a thing called the Gospel Coalition, which was in its heyday during that neutral period. And he's being interviewed by a guy, and the guy's asking him about homosexuality. And he kept asking him, is it wrong? And Keller, he wouldn't say it's wrong. Well, it doesn't produce the best for society. And he doing everything he could not to say the Bible says no. And I'm thinking, you know what that is? That's when everything's neutral, that's egalitarianism. Everybody's accepted. There's no right, wrong. And he's built a big, gigantic church in New York City, thousands of people on that kind of mentality. Well, as a Bible believer, I can't do that. I can be kind as I can be. I can be as compassionate as I can. Communicate the truth as lovingly as you can. But it still has to be truth. In nothing terrified by your adversary. You got adversaries out there, folks. And it's not just people that think we're nuts because we don't water baptize people. Now, I've had those kind of adversaries all my ministry and never worried about them. But the guy that lives next door to me, that idea doesn't even come into his head. But this other stuff does. Which is to them a token, an evident token of perdition. Well, you're going to hell for sure because you don't agree with what I'm saying. But to you of salvation and that of God. For unto you, and here's the thing, it is given in the behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me and not here to be in me. When he says it's given to you on behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, you've been given the privilege to trust Christ. You're also given the privilege to suffer for him. The way you should do it is gladly. It's okay. I understand what's going on. And I understand if I'm standing for the truth, doing it. And you do it. Paul says, do good unto all men, especially the household of faith. When the apostles in Acts 2, the Jerusalem apostles, they'd agreed to go to the circumcision and Paul to the heathen. And Galatians 2:10 says, only they said, be sure to remember the poor saints in Jerusalem. And Paul said, I was already forward to do it. I was already doing that before they mentioned it. Nobody does good to people that are in need more than Christian people do. Don't have a compassionate heart for all men. You go around the planet, and everywhere missionaries have gone, hospitals and those kind of things have popped up. Why? Because you see the needs. And Christian people are the ones that do those kind of things. Giving of themselves. But when the suffering, when the adversaries say, we're not going to tolerate you. Okay, I understand why it is. And do it. It's the privilege that we have. And frankly, you're going to live in a world like Paul lived in. Same conflict you see in him. You're going to be involved in that. And when you are, hey, the first three, I've said it many times, the first three centuries, check church history, the first three centuries, the church, the body of Christ grew faster and larger than it has in any three centuries since then. And it wasn't because they had internet, and it wasn't because they had cell phones. You know what it was? It was because the Roman Empire went through two or three pandemics. And it was Christian people that ministered. And their ministering changed the hearts, demonstrated the compassion of Christ in them, and got an opening for the gospel. So, why do kids kill kids? It's called sin. And it's a systemic problem. And all the politicians and the leaders, religious leaders, whatever, ignoring it won't change it, make it worse. You and I have an answer. Getting that message of the gospel. Listen, there ought not be any more passion, anything that could sit in the back of your mind to guide your future than being a lighthouse, your home, this ministry, being a lighthouse to share the truth of God's word, the compassion, the love of God, and his grace. So I say all this to you. It's Wednesday night, it's just us. I know you came to study Ezekiel. We're not going to study Ezekiel for about three or four more weeks, but we'll get there. I've got two other lessons I've got to teach before I can teach Ezekiel, according to my wife, according to the people back there that do the taping and the distributing of the tapes and stuff. But I just want to say that to you because I just frustrated today listening. Every time you turn the news on, it's just, oh, what are we going to do? Oh, you know, what are you going to weep in? Weep with those that weep and cry with those that cry. I get that. And then the politician, the political opportunists come along, and I get all that. But the thing that echoes out is none of them have any answers because they're in a position where there are no answers. You're just down to the place where sin is doing its job. He says three times, gave him up, gave him over. There are a lot of reasons for the three. One is it takes 3 to 4 generations to change a culture. So you're not going to go out and have a great revival and change it back immediately. But you can be a start with your family on the future. Okay? All right. I'd ask if there are any questions, but the kids hadn't gone out yet. Have they? Yeah. No. That's the little kids. Mike still got them back there. Okay. All right. Well, praise the Lord. Nice to see all of you tonight. Didn't want to be a downer, but I guess it's kind of a downer. But today's been a downer day. If you listen, I don't listen to a lot of the news, but everywhere you went today, that's all you heard. And the thing that the illustration about agitation, frustration, and agitation, frustration, Well, I'll tell you some other time. It's time to go. But there, I'm sorry?
It's just real. That's what's going on.
Yeah. All right. Anyway, remember Romans 1 and Romans 3. I like Romans 3 better than Romans 1. But Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace. We just pray as we live our lives and have Christ living in us. Try to walk in the truth of your word. We pray we take advantage of the opportunities around us just to love people. Be a source of encouragement in a bewildered world. And even when it's not a popular thing to preach the gospel, we can live our lives in a way that give that become the gospel of Christ, that are attracted to it, so that we do have the opportunity. It isn't just preaching out of the wind, not preaching out of any desire to condemn or shame people, but out of a heart of love that has answers. And we pray as we do that, that our Savior would be honored. And we pray for the world that we live in, that the light of the gospel is the answer. So we just pray we'd be a part of sending that light in Christ's name. Amen.